Happy Sunday to everybody, and welcome to August. And actually, this Sunday makes 7 years that I have been your pastor. It was 7 years ago, beginning in August, that I began that role, and continue to be very grateful and thankful for the role that you play in my life and the life of my family. And we are honored to be able to be here among you and count you as friends and brothers and sisters in the Lord. So thank you for 7 awesome years together. Looking forward to what this year has in store. Lots of crazy stuff going on still. We're still in the midst of the COVID thing, and we're watching the Douglas County Health Department to be able to kind of keep track of when we should open up. Ideally, we're kind of looking at August 22nd when school opens up. Maybe we can get back to church, but we're watching that carefully, and we'll make those decisions as we get closer to time, because as we know, things can change one way or another very quickly. So just a target date. We'll see how that goes as things unwind over here during this month. We appreciate your offerings that you're sending in. Either drop them by the church or send them to post office box 245 and it will get to us. We do have a board meeting on Wednesday, August 12th at 7 p.m. here at the church, with masks or with on Zoom. So whichever you're comfortable with, if you want to be a part of Zoom, let me know about that. And so when we do get back to church, you know, we kind of know what we're going to do, and we're going to follow a lot of precautions, but we're going to just take it day at a time and see how it's going to work for everybody. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father God in heaven, we know that the disruption of COVID is caused a lot of inconveniences and disappointments in our lives. And I just pray that we would be able to trust you with whatever comes in each new day, that we would let the light of Jesus be our guide, that we would be able to walk on the path that you have for each of us, even if it's a path that we wouldn't have chosen for ourselves, but we know that we are not alone. Thank you for the unity of the body. Thank you for the fact that we can be the church even from our living rooms. Thank you for the fact that we can be helping your kingdom grow no matter where we're at and what we're doing and what the circumstances are. God, thank you so much. I pray for school as it's trying to get opened up and all the adjustments that teachers and staff and administration are making and students will have to make and parents and bus drivers, and it affects a lot of people. And I just pray that you would bring a real clear path for everyone involved in that as we gear up for that in the next few weeks. We pray for our medical community and for those that are making decisions in government about how to handle things. And we pray for the business owners and for those that are trying to keep things moving forward even in these uncertain times. Lord, I just pray that the trust in you and hope in you will grow and deepen through this season of our lives. Lord, I just pray that you would help our nation as we enter into a politically charged season with elections and coming up, and with all the different tensions we have with not just with COVID, but with race and with the finances and with just feeling like we're such a country that's divided and falling apart and fragmenting. Lord, help us to learn to love one another. Help us to come together under the Constitution and under the flag and under the identity that we have as Americans, and be one nation and work together for the good. Help us to live our lives each as citizens in a way that would promote peace and unity and good things and equality for all people. Lord, guide us as we try to do that. We pray for those that are sick, some people dealing with just sicknesses, some with chronic diseases, some with life-threatening things. I just pray, Lord, that for each situation, that we would be able to see your healing, that we would be able to see your touch and your peace come, and we just pray that for your care to come upon everyone who needs it right now. God, I ask that as we go into today, that we would be able to take a look at how grand you are and what worship looks like, and what even a glimpse of heaven, what that looks like today. Lord, as we work through our way through Revelation, may these chapters come alive inside of our hearts and in our minds as we seek to worship you. We pray these things in your name. Amen. As I just said, our sermon today is going to take us into chapters 4 and 5 of Revelation, where John, the Apostle John, is given a glimpse into heaven. And so when we pray, we know that our prayers are reaching that very throne that we'll be looking at today, and that God listens and he cares, and the praises reach heaven, and we're very thankful for that. We can connect with the Lord, and that's what we do through prayer. Before we get into the sermon here, I'd like us to just reflect on not just the love of Jesus to us, but how we can love Jesus back. That's a great goal to have for each day is, Jesus, how can I show you my love? And this song reminds us of that. Take it away, Judy. Moving through our series on Revelation, and if I keep repeating every week stuff we've done before in too much detail, then that would be the whole sermon itself, because we're adding different layers to our understanding of this book as it unfolds. And so if you miss any of the sermons, I just encourage you to go back and listen to them so that you can see how it all fits together a little better, because I'm always referring to things that are based on some other things that we've talked about as we're moving through this book. So if you have a chance, go on back on YouTube or Facebook and catch up on some things so that we can get a bigger, more clear picture of this book that's already pretty difficult to understand. And one reason it's hard to understand because it's written in layers. It's written in layers, like an onion, as a famous donkey once said. Things that have meaning for the first century church is one way to interpret the book of Revelation, because it was written to seven literal churches in that time, in AD 96. But there's also meaning for the lives of people who will live in the last generation as the second coming of the Lord appears on this earth. So there's things written to them. But there's also meaning for every generation, because I believe that this book has enough allegorical and symbolic things that apply to every generation of Christians, including our own today. So we're kind of going to look a little bit at each of those different levels as we go through the book of Revelation, knowing that it is something that we're told in chapters 1, verse 3, that we are blessed when we read this book, and we're blessed when we put it into action. So if it's something just for a certain generation and there's nothing to receive for every generation, then we miss out on the blessing of the book. And so I believe that every generation can be blessed by the words of this book in Revelation. We do know that Revelation is a book about Jesus, and it's given from him himself. He's revealing a lot about himself, and he reveals over and over again, and we'll see it again today, that God, that Jesus is God yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He is the God of all time, and we can trust him. It's a book written to those seven real churches during John's time. But those seven churches, especially number seven, stands for perfection. So they represent all of churches for all time. So it's written to us as well. Revelation is full of symbols and numbers, as we talked about last week. And so many of these symbols and numbers go back to the Old Testament, and it ties the Bible together. It's not just some weird addition to the end of the Bible. It all really fits together very well. As we go through it, we'll be referring back to a lot of things in the Old Testament and even about Jesus himself in the Gospels. In a way, the book of Revelation is kind of like a trip to the art museum. You go to one room and you see some statues from ancient Rome. You go to another room, you find some paintings from some French impressionists. You go to another room, you find some contemporary art. You go to another room, you might find some miniature dollhouses. There's so many different things you see in an art museum. And there's no right or wrong way to experience a museum like that. You go to each room and you spend as long as you want there, or you may say, yeah, this isn't for me, and you go on to the next room. But you find something you really like, you stop, you look at it, you analyze it, you think about what you appreciate about it, and the beauty and the meaning that's in that work of art, and you experience it in a way. And that's kind of what we're doing with Revelation. We're going to go into a museum where each chapter, each passage is like a room with a big picture to it. And you may go to that room and go, I don't really get that very well. It doesn't really hit me very well because it's hard to understand. And I get that. And we're going to try to make it so that those things aren't so hard to understand. But you also go into it and you see the beauty and you see the wonder and you see the mystery of it. And you go, wow, I'm walking away having seen a picture that impacts my life and I can experience it. And it's something that's changing me. If we try to read Revelation through chronologically, it's not going to work because many things are repeated throughout the book, the same scenes or events, but sometimes it's given certain an angle here and a different angle there. And so if you start reading through something and you go, I think I read about that back there, well, you probably did. Okay, so we have to kind of jump around a little bit. And in my sermons, we're going to be jumping around a little bit, not just going through it chronologically. And John had four different visions, okay, that are put together in this book of Revelation. There are four different times that John says, I was caught up in the spirit, and Jesus revealed this to me, and he revealed this to me. And so we're kind of putting it all together in one book here. And so just be patient. And if it doesn't all make sense and it's a little bit confusing, join the crowd because I've been experiencing that lately as well as I'm studying this and I'm putting way more hours into preparation for these sermons than I have any other series that I've done because I'm on a big learning curve. I'm trying to figure some of this out myself, and seeing the depths of this book has been a wonderful blessing already for myself. So pray for me as I prepare, and I'm praying for you as you are listening and studying along with us with me as well. Okay, today, chapters 4 and 5. These are scenes that take place in heaven. So it starts out by saying this in the first two verses. After this, I looked, John is writing, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, and there was one seated on the throne. Okay, so that's our introduction here because until now, John is on an island on earth and he sees a vision. The first three chapters we went through was a vision, and he hears the words, but now John is ushered into the dimension of heaven, very much alive in the Spirit of God, and he's shown everything as an eyewitness. Now we know he hasn't died yet and gone to heaven. We'll see a reason why in just a little bit, but he's caught into the Spirit in there. And later on in Revelation, we're going to see a different view of heaven. It's going to be slightly different from a different angle because that's a future heaven. And right now, the heaven that John is taken to that we're going to read today is what was going on right there in AD 96. And since we're living today in AD 2020, it's the same era as John's AD 96. And it's safe to assume that this is as close to a view of the present heaven as we ever get. It's kind of like what heaven is like even now. And there's some reasons why we believe that that's still a current, present thing, and we'll get to that. So worship, the worship that takes place in heaven, is going to be our theme today. And hopefully we can learn some things about our worship today as we're taking into the vision of heaven that John saw. It's a beautiful thing. I hope you enjoy this today. So we're going to read through the whole passage right now. Chapters 4 and 5, they're really short chapters, but they kind of fit together. And then we're going to go back and make some observations. And it's kind of like we're going into one of the rooms of the museum that we were talking about. And we see the room that that looks like heaven now. And it's one of the grandest exhibitions of all. And we're going to get to see what John saw. So join along with me here. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones. And seated on those thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne, there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, were four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And the four living creatures, day and night, they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders, they fall down before him who is seated on the throne, and they worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look onto it. And I began to weep loudly, because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered, so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing, as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and a golden bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made a kingdom and a priest to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. Whew. It's very beautiful, but kind of frightening, isn't it? Lots of descriptions. Some are literal, and some are had the appearance of. In other words, we're back to similes again. It's like this, but it's using the best words that John could find. And we go, whoa, at this whole description here. And it's interesting how we squabble over our worship wars. Is it contemporary? Is it traditional? Is it this or that? You know, up in heaven, it's not contemporary or traditional or a blend of anything. It's its own unique thing. That's what worship looks like in heaven. And I don't think our worship here looks anything really like there, but yet the Spirit is there. And that's important that we look at today. You know, worship has five components to it that we see here in this chapter. And I think if we get those five components there and we're worshiping in spirit and in truth, it really doesn't matter the style that we're in. It could be a hymn with an organ, or it could be electric guitars and Rob on the drums, okay? We are worshipers even here on earth, and we look at the worship that goes on in heaven. Should we change our worship service to look like it did in heaven there? There'd be a lot of special effects we'd have to work on, wouldn't it? Anyway, we're going to look at this today in five different ways. The first thing is that worship centers. That's not a noun, it's a verb. It centers, it's focused, okay? Worship centers us on the throne in the center of heaven and centered upon the one who sits upon the throne. I mean, all of these dazzling special effects in heaven. I mean, the focus is still not on that, but on the throne and he who sits upon the throne. There are colors of precious stones. They reflect the light from the throne and they shine with vibrant hues next to a crystal sea and rainbows of light and color and lightning and thunder. And in the Old Testament, in both Isaiah 6, Ezekiel 1, and Daniel chapter 7, those prophets were given similar glimpses of God in heaven. The descriptions are very similar to this. And while we might not reproduce all the special effects here on earth, in our sanctuary, or in our living rooms where we're worshiping now, or wherever we worship, we know that Jesus is the center of it all. He's the center of worship. The second thing is that worship gathers. Wow, we look at who is in this cast of characters in heaven right now. There's the seven spirits of God. There's the 24 elders, there's the four living creatures, there's the angels, and there's all of creation. You know, right now we're not gathering necessarily in worship in one spot, but that's okay because even here we see that worship can take place everywhere, you know, all over in heaven and on earth, in the sea, everywhere, okay, that it can take place. Now the seven spirits, we talked about that last week. It's not seven different spirits, but it's seven representing perfection, which is the Spirit of God, which is perfect. And he is there at the throne. He is symbolized by torches of fire because the Spirit is a fire that burns out all the bad and creates something pure and good. The 24 elders, that's a little bit of a mystery. They're certainly not angels. And some say that they're heavenly beings. They're not people, they're not angels, they're just something different in a category, which is what I kind of tend to think as well. I'm not going to die on this hill because we don't really understand that, but there are 24 elders who are there. And if you think about it, 12 and 12, you know, things in the Bible happened in 12s, which was a sense of completion. And if you take the two most famous 12s of the Bible, you're thinking, okay, in the Old Testament, 12 sons of Israel, of Jacob, that represent the family of God as God worked in Old Testament times. And you think about the 12 disciples who became the 12 apostles upon whom the church was built. If you take the 12 of the Old Testament and the 12 of the New Testament, you take law and grace and you bring it together, it's a great representation of what has happened in all of history and that before the throne of God, whether you're under the old covenant of the Old Testament or the new covenant of the new, we are under one covenant that comes together before the Lord. So I think that the 12 and the 12, they represent in some ways Israel and the church. And the fact that they're wearing these crowns, these victor crowns that they put down before the Lord, you know, it's a way of showing that we are overcomers as well. Through the law of the Old Testament, through the grace of the New Testament coming together, God's people Israel and God's people the church. I think there's a sense of unity there, and that's going to be my take on the interpretation of those 24 elders. You may disagree somewhere along the way. A lot of theologians do, but that's the take I'm going to go with today. And then we have another set of characters that's even more strange and mysterious. It's the four living creatures, okay? What we have here is the strength of four different parts of God's creation. We have the lion, which is the strength of the wild. We have the ox, who's the strength of the domesticated animals. We have the eagle, which is the strength of the birds. And we have the human, which is the strength of mankind. and merged in together these four creatures that represent the strength of God's creation are there joining in the praise. We have angels who are present and joining in as well. And we get a vague picture that everyone else is alive in heaven or on earth, praising God in the last finale, the last part of it there. And so that's another sign that this scene in heaven takes place in present tense, because there are saints in heaven and there's saints on earth. So this is taking place during the time of John, and I believe during our time as well, it continues. The third thing worship does is that it reveals, because when we worship, we see more of God. You know, they bring out a scroll. The scroll is the scripture. They didn't have books that opened up like we do back then. It was everything that was written was on papyrus, on the scroll that would be opened and pulled out. And when God's people gathered in the synagogue or the temple, the scrolls were opened up. Imagine the hush of the crowd as they waited to hear what God had to say. They didn't have their own scrolls at home with God's word on it. They had to gather together to be able to hear it. And there was probably just one copy per community. It was a pretty rare, precious thing. But in this instance, the scrolls are being opened up to be read in heaven. But yet, they couldn't be opened because they were sealed shut. Back in Roman times, when this was made, a document would have seals on it made of wax to be able to protect it from being opened up. And that only the one that had the authority to open it up was allowed to break those seals. In this instance, there were seven seals on it, which sounds like it could be related to, in their culture, if a scroll had seven seals on it, that meant that it was a will. It was sealed by the author who made it and six witnesses that they had to have for a will. And so it's almost like this will is being opened. This inheritance is being opened. You know, it's showing, I think this is like the book of life up in heaven, showing whose names are written in there, who are covered by the blood of the Lamb. So I think that's who we're talking about, what we're talking about here when we think about that scroll. Well, who can open up the scroll, the book of life that has the names of those who are able to enter into heaven? Well, we got to see who could open it. Of course, anybody could go along and open it up and break the seals, but not the person who has the authority. You know, the person who has authority is supposed to do it. It's kind of like our modern day PIN codes. Somebody could steal it from you and get into your bank account through your PIN code, but only the people who have the authority to use that card know the PIN code, right? And so that's kind of the way it works a little bit. John sees these seals on here, and he's upset because nobody can open it. And that's why we know that John is not dead in heaven, because John's weeping, and we know there's no tears in heaven. So he's just an innocent bystander, just like you or me, going, there's this scroll here that's got the names of those who can enter into here, but who can open it so we can read those names? And so he starts to weep about it. But you know what? I wonder, though, if we gathered for worship here on earth and the scrolls, the word of God, was closed and it couldn't be open, how would we respond? Would we be like John and we would weep and cry that we don't have access to God's word? I mean, what if you came to church once we were back meeting again, or even online, and all I did was read a nice poem, or I read a Dr. Seuss book about speeches, or Yertle the Turtle that had a nice moral story to it, or I just encouraged us, just said, just let's go out and be good people this week, but never cracked open the word of God? Would you weep? Would you be sad that we would not go to the source of life right there? Would we weep if God's word stayed closed? Let's open it up and let's enjoy what's in there. Worship involves preaching. It involves opening the word. It involves reading the good news of the gospel and inviting the sinner and demonstrating the personal dimensions of the eternal and glorious will of God. We need God's word, and God's word is valuable to us. But the one with authority was found after all. The one who had the authority to break the seals and open it up was the Lamb of God who shed his blood. He has the authority, the right, and the honor to open and read for all of heaven to hear. The next thing worship does is that worship sings. It's the response to opening the word of God, and the one who is on the throne is praised, provided through a song. We sing in whom our souls delight. Old hymns, new songs, we express the truth of God as our soul connects with him. There are five songs listed in this scene of heaven in chapters 4 and 5. The first one was a quartet sung by the four living creatures, okay? The lion, the ox, the eagle, the human. They're praising God. They say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And we've seen this phrase, was, is, and is to come, but actually, when we saw it before this, it was written in a different order. It wasn't past, present, future. It was actually present, past, and future. It's the one who is and was and is to come. And maybe you didn't notice that before, and I didn't make a big deal about it before, because in the previous uses, it was taking place here on earth, where we need reassurance. First of all, Jesus is with us now in the present tense. It's easy to get Jesus in the past, and it's kind of easy to get Jesus in the future, but in heaven now, as John is witnessing it, time has a very different dimension, okay? It was past and present and future, because from heaven's vantage point, Jesus ties all of time together. Now, we're going to see two more scenes of heaven in chapters 11 and 16, and when they repeat this phrase, they're going to leave out one of them. They're going to leave out the future. They're going to say the God who is and the God who was, because the future is already there. That's how we know that this scene of heaven is different than the other scenes of heaven. Because in the other scenes of heaven, in the future, there is no more future, because it's the end of time. And eternity is in a different dimension, and it's just always present tense. We don't understand it, but anyway. We remember that in the past, that the Lamb of God took away the sins of the world, and he's with us in the present. But when we get to heaven, we don't have to worry about the future, because heaven is one big long today. The second song was by a choir of the 24 elders. They sing a song, another song about God the Creator. "Worthy are you, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." And then that choir of 24 elders joined with the four living creatures. They sing together another song, not about just about the God who created, but the God who creates a new kingdom, the new kingdom of God. They sing, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." And the fourth song is sung by all of them, the quartet of the four, the choir of the 24, and the multitude of angels. They sing another song about Christ, who's the Redeemer, symbolized by the Lamb of God. "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." These songs introduce Jesus as the authority to break the seals, because as we read in chapter 5, verse 5, it says he's the Lion of Judah. He's the root of David. Jesus is the conqueror. He's the king. John hears the lion, but in the next verse, he turns around and does he see a lion? No. He sees what instead? He sees a lamb. He hears the roar, but his eyes see a quiet and humble and helpless lamb. I remember a trip to the zoo one time, and I watched this lion wake up, stretch, and all of a sudden, as it stood up, it gave this roar. Wow, it was one of the scariest sounds I ever heard. I wasn't expecting that to come out, but you could hear it far and wide. And roars do not come from little sheep. Is Jesus a lion or a lamb? He's both. He's the mighty king, but he's also the sacrificial lamb, all wrapped up into one paradoxical being. The lion's power comes through the lamb's patience. The lion's success comes through the lamb's surrender. The lion's supremacy comes through the lamb's service. Patience, service, surrender, service. I mean, these things are all about Jesus. That's what his life was like. Maybe you caught that strange verse in chapter 5, verse 6. It says that the lamb had seven horns and seven eyes. And you thought, ew, I don't like that image of Jesus. That's kind of scary looking. I don't like it either. But remember, in Revelation, numbers are symbols. So what does the number 7 represent? It represents perfection. Okay, lambs don't have seven horns and seven eyes. Okay, so this description is not about just an ordinary lamb, but about the perfect Lamb of God. Horns represent strength. This lamb has perfect power. And eyes represent understanding, seeing everything. And so this lamb has perfect wisdom. The perfect Lamb of God, who's perfect in power and wisdom, gives his life for who? Me and you, for sinners. He didn't die because he was dumb and weak. His sacrifice was made with wisdom, and his sacrifice was made with power, making salvation possible. And that is who we worship in heaven, and who we worship in heaven from here on earth, the Lion, who is also the Lamb. And we have a song about that that was written a few years back. We sing it at church from time to time. It's our own song about the Lion and the Lamb.
Clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God. Our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion. Of the world, his blood breaks the chains. chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
The fifth song, we'll get back to our sermon here. We're about to finish up here. I know I've gone a little long today, but there's so much of this chapter to share, so I couldn't get it down any shorter than that. But it says that in the last song that all these voices, the quartet of four living creatures, the 24 elders, the multitude of angels, and including those who are singing in heaven and on earth, everybody joins the song. That says, to Him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. We all get to sing that song together in our own way, in our own styles, but we're all praising God in spirit and in truth. The last thing that worship does is that it affirms. When the singing is over, they exclaim what? They say, amen. Okay, almost every, we've talked about this every week so far. The word amen means so be it, Lord. And the response to God, the response to Jesus is, amen, so be it, Lord. And when we pray to God, we end with amen, not as just a formality or we just saying some weird word to say, okay, everybody can open their eyes now. But the word amen means so be it, Lord. We're praying in your will. We're praying that your kingdom will be done here on earth just as it is in heaven. And so that word amen is our affirmation of who we're worshiping, who Jesus is. It's our recurrent and our emphatic yes to worship as we see God more clearly, His ways and His purposes. So Revelation gives us this glimpse into heaven because when we get weary of the hard life here on earth, we need this reminder that Jesus is on the throne and that He's got it taken care of. We don't have to be afraid over the uncertain future because today Jesus is King. And tomorrow, Jesus is King. And the next day after that, Jesus is who? He's King. And even when the cataclysmic events come at the end of time with the second coming, He is still King. So next week, we're going to skip to some chapters where we see the king of evil. We're going to contrast the one who's the counterfeit, the one who thinks he's the king. He's called the beast. He sits on a throne here on earth, being worshipped by earth's inhabitants, while he blasphemes the real King of heaven, while he blasphemes and denies freedom for anyone on earth to worship the real God in heaven. So we're going to have a big contrast here. We're going from this beautiful scene in heaven. We're going to see some pretty ugly things in the next two sermons as we look at the counterfeits, those that are the enemies of God and trying to uprise against him. So we're going to get to those here. And you know, the last days, you know, when the second coming comes, could end up being the worst days that the earth has ever seen, even worse than 2020. But we never have to fear because Jesus is still on his throne. So whatever your trial is, your hardship, your tribulation that you're experiencing right now in your life, there's a parallel universe going up in heaven, even right now, that's going on with the scene that we saw today. There's a God on the throne, being praised as the Lamb of God because he loved you so much that he sacrificed his life in order to have a relationship with you. And we respond in faith. We respond in humility and repentance and say, Jesus, thank you for forgiving me of my sins, for taking that on my punishment and giving me new life with you so that I can enjoy you both now on earth and in the future when we get to heaven. It's not like he's sitting on the throne, so busy, caught up with all the praises that he ignores what's going on down here on earth. He's very aware and active in our lives. He's a God who is able to bend his ear to us, a God that is worthy enough to look down and see faithful hearts, and a God that's worthy enough to send his loving thoughts our way, and his love and wisdom and power comes to us. He reaches out his heart and his hand, and he meets us where we're at. And those horns and eyes on the Lamb of God just represent that perfect power and understanding. And if you're feeling like you have a God that's not very powerful and not very understanding, you're missing who he is. And so he is not far from you right now, offering you that power and understanding. It's not right that the royal lion had to become a sacrificial lamb. And it's not right that you and I have to go through these trials of life. But these are seasons. And God plunged himself into the worst of the pain, the worst of the injustices, and the deepest human tragedies. He knows, he's been there, and he's still there with us as the King of Heaven.
Here I am, Lord, and I'm drowning in your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me, and it echoes in my mind. Keeps me awake tonight. I know you cast my sin as far as the east is from the west, and I stand before you now as though I've never sinned. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. You know just how far the east is from the west, one scarred hand to the other. The day the war begins, endless reminding of my sin. Time and time again, the truth is drowned out by the storm I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, one scarred hand to the other. I know you've washed me white, turned my darkness into light. I need your peace to get me through this night. I can't live by what I feel about the truth your word reveals, and I'm not holding on to you, but you're holding on to me. I don't have to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. You know just how far the east is from the west, one scar head to the other. Just how far the east is from the west, just how far is from the west, one star and to the other.
Let us pray. Dear God, we know that you have separated us from our sins as far as the east is from the west, as far as one nailed scarred hand to another. And Lord, that beautiful poetry comes together to remind us how loved we are, how precious is the death of Jesus, because it brings salvation and life to our dead spirits. God, I thank you so much for what you've done for us. And as we go into this communion time today, we are reminded that we are forgiven and free to be the creations that you've made, that we can live out that relationship with you as we go through our day-to-day lives. Thank you, dear Jesus, for that. And we love you. In your name we pray. Amen. Jesus showed his love to us by going to the cross for us and offering us that gift of salvation. As we take the bread and the cup, it's one way to be able to just stop and pause and say, thank you, Lord, for who you are and what you've done. And let me show my love to you. A type of commitment and dedication again and again is to remember what it's all about. So as we take the bread, we're reminded of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for us, and we take it in remembrance of him. And the cup reminds us of the blood of Jesus Christ that's given for the forgiveness of our sins, and we take it and we drink it in remembrance of him. These few weeks of Revelation, we've been looking at the good guy of Revelation, Jesus. We've learned a lot about him over these Sundays. The next couple weeks, though, we're going to take the other extreme, and we're going to look at the bad guys in Revelation. We're going to see who Jesus is up against and who he's going to eventually have victory over. Don't fear, because yes, the Lamb of God takes away the sins of the world. He defeats the bad guys and he brings complete and total salvation to his beloved. And we're going to further get into the deeper part of Revelation. We're going to skip ahead because it's not written really chronologically. And so we're going to look at it topically now. Now we've gone through chapter 5. We're going to skip. If you want to read ahead, you can read chapters 12 and 13 and 17. Those are where we're going over the next two Sundays. So if you want to read about the bad guys of Revelation, that's a good place to go. May God bless you and keep you as you go through this week. May you be able to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. And may you share it with others. If you need anything, let me know. I'm right here.